Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Trapping, Turkeys, and Thanksgiving by Tonya Kappes, narrated by Johanna Parker. Chapter 1. It was a whiff. A brief moment, really. Enough of a moment that it got my attention and took me right back to the small kitchen of my childhood home in Perrysburg, Kentucky. A far cry from where I stood at the kitchen sink at the milkery, where my hands were busy peeling the shells off hard-boiled eggs. Be sure you knock it against the sink all the way around the outside before you start to peel. Mary Elizabeth gave me the side eye when she must have seen me staring out the window. I know my hard-boiled eggs are delicious, but they look good when you have the nice and shiny, smooth outside. Especially when they're sitting in the little egg holder of the antique china of my mama's, which one day soon will be yours. Her voice trilled with excitement. Hank and I have no place to put any extra dishes, I told her, knowing she was going to try to pass off all her china, vases, family cloth napkins, and things I'd need to host a southern dinner party, which was not on my radar, even if I didn't live in a camper van. I picked up another hard-boiled egg from the pan of cold water. As I knocked it along the ceramic sink, I carefully rotated it to make sure it was cracking all the outside of the shell. You'll have to find a place. You are also going to have to get a bigger refrigerator to keep a frozen coffee cake. So when you do have company drop by, you will have something good for them to eat on a beautiful serving plate. She sighed happily at the thought of my impending nuptials to Hank Sharp, even though the wedding wouldn't be until the next year. Which does make me wonder if you two have talked about a real house. Nope, we've not discussed anything about the wedding. Though I do think I've narrowed down my bridesmaids. I knew I had to give Mary Elizabeth something to chew on to get her through the holidays. The bell over the front door of the milkery sounded, signaling a new bed and breakfast guest for her. Hold that thought. She picked up the edges of her apron and wiped her hands clean before she reached around to untie it, threw it on the kitchen table, looked into the microwave as a mirror to make sure she was presentable, and darted out of the kitchen to meet her new guests. The back door swung open. Abby Fawn Bonds, my sister-in-law, peeked inside. Knock, knock. Anyone home? Abby's eyes darted around. Thank goodness you are here. I tossed the broken eggshells in the empty coffee tin Mary Elizabeth had given me so she could use the shells to compost and put in the milkery garden to help fertilize the soil. Mary Elizabeth has some dishes for you and Bobby Ray. Oh, no, you don't. We've already turned them down. We told her it was only right for the daughter to get them. She snickered and pulled off her coat. It's turned downright cold. I think we skipped right over fall and went straight to winter. Fine by me. I gave her a hug after she'd hung her coat up on the hook next to the door. I'm so ready for the season to slow down. I laughed. I never thought I'd say it, but I need a break. After I got Happy Trails Campground, the campground I owned and lived in, up and running as one of the best campgrounds in the state, we were always packed, even during the winter months. But it was those few months where the more experienced campers came, because it wasn't as packed as the seasonal months. They didn't require all my attention, and over the last couple of camping seasons, we'd been swamped, leaving me little time to think about, much less plan, a wedding. If the weather is going to be anything like the almanac says, we're in for big winter storms, starting on Thanksgiving. She sighed and walked over to wash her hands before picking up an egg to help me. That's just a few days away. I glanced back out the window and looked up at the skyline on top of the mountains of the Daniel Boone National Forest. How many more do you think we need? She told me there's about 15 guests. She looked down at the bowl of unshelled eggs. This is a lot more than 15 guests. Keep shelling, I giggled and picked one up. I was able to peel them while looking out at the orange, red, gold, and green colors dotting the mountainside. Fall, in and around the park, was a picture like nothing else I'd ever seen. I certainly didn't take it for granted. Autumn was my favorite season. Hank and I hadn't made a true wedding date, but as the fall season was quickly passing by, with the first snowfall of the year, my heart was being tugged to plan a gorgeous fall wedding, which meant we'd have to wait almost an entire year. It was fine. It wasn't like either of us was going anywhere. Hank and Jerry Truman had started their own private investigation service, keeping him busy. Happy Trails Campground was literally booked solid for the next 2 years, which had me tied up so the year would fly by. I wouldn't tell my thoughts to Mary Elizabeth or even Abby just yet. It was only fair of me to consider Hank and his thoughts. Discussing it with him first would be the best thing to do. The faint whiff of paprika circled me again, taking me right back to my childhood, where I stood on a small stool next to my mama, not Mary Elizabeth, but my birth mother, and helped her sprinkle the top of her hard-boiled eggs with the spice. "There she goes again," I heard Mary Elizabeth's voice behind me. "She's been daydreaming all morning." "You okay?" Abby leaned over the sink and looked at me. "You seem distracted." "It's funny how you get one little smell of something, and a whole host of feelings come sweeping in with a flood of memories." I put the egg down and picked up the paprika. "This reminds me of my mom when I was a little girl and doing this exact same thing." "Then we won't use it." Abby plucked it from my hand and hurried off toward the butler's pantry. "Anything that will make you sad will not be used for this Thanksgiving." "It's fine, it's fine," I shrugged. "I love my memories of my mom when I get them. They've started to fade." This was something I knew would naturally occur as I got older. The memories of my parents and siblings, along with the sound of their voices, something I tried so hard to keep, were starting to fade or take on a different image than what was true. The facts were the facts. They were deceased. I was adopted by Mary Elizabeth when I was a teenager, and now, close to 30, I'd been with Mary Elizabeth longer than my birth family. I, too, recently had some of those memories. Abby nibbled on her lip, her brows furrowed. "You can't imagine my shock when Lester Hager walked into the library. Just seeing him again reminded me of all the work I'd done for the church at the library when he was the preacher." "Are you talking about Lester, Betts's husband?" Don Gentry came into the kitchen. "I know you've told this story a million times, but I've not heard it myself." Don indicated the gossip mill was running wild with the governor's recent pardon of two citizens of normal Kentucky. "I'm not sure if you knew, but a few months ago, I'd gone to see Lester in the prison." I glanced at Abby and smiled. We, Abby, Betts Hager, Dottie Swaggart, Queenie French, and I, were known as the Laundry Club Ladies. We were a group of best friends of different ages who loved to eat, read, and had a knack for sleuthing out criminals. It was something we just so happened upon once during our book club, and now we were like those crime podcasts, but real-life armchair detectives. Unfortunately, Lester Hager was the normal Baptist preacher who'd killed someone. It was for self-defense, but it was still a crime, and he was sent to life in prison until recently. I continued. "I was snooping around and knew Lester might have some prison insider information." I grabbed the coffee carafe and headed over to the kitchen table to refill my mug from earlier. Abby and Dawn gestured to me to fill their cups as we all took a seat at the table. "Lester confided to me he'd been diagnosed with cancer and didn't have much longer to live. Though Lester did a horrific crime of taking someone's life, he was still a person, and I had felt awful for him. He made me promise not to tell Betts, and for months, I would avoid her questioning me about seeing him because he took her off his list of visitors. It was one of the hardest things I'd ever had to do. Out of all the laundry club ladies, Betts was probably the best friend and confidant of all of them. Just thinking about Lester's secret still made my heart hurt, even though things had since changed. He thought if he took Betts off his list, she'd just forget about him, and that he'd die without her knowing what he'd passed from. The reasoning was ridiculous, but I only wanted what was best for my friend. So when Lester first presented this crazy notion, I kept it to myself." Dawn held onto the mug with one hand while her other hand picked at the edges of her pixie cut. Her hair was coal black, as were her clothes. She had on a pair of skinny black jeans, a black tank top, and a black leather jacket. She wore the jacket as more of a shirt than a jacket. Dawn had stayed in Happy Trails Campground when one of her famous author clients was in town to ride and escape the daily grind of fame. Dawn ended up forming an unlikely relationship with Mary Elizabeth. Neither of them lived here, but the milkery, the local dairy farm, had become available to purchase. They went into business together and literally transformed the milkery into an amazing working dairy farm and bed and breakfast. One night, there was a knock at my camper van door. I laughed out loud, recalling the night. Fifi and I thought it was Hank and Chester. Fifi was my little poodle, and Chester was Hank's dog. Hank lived full-time in the campground, so it wasn't uncommon for them to venture over when they were out for a walk or couldn't sleep. I swung the door open, and there stood Lester and Grady Cox Jr. Without going into too much detail about Grady Cox Jr., I continued to tell her about Lester. Lester told me the governor had pardoned both of them. Grady Jr., who went by Junior, was a questionable pardon, but the governor didn't care. He was going out of office, and a lot of the pardons he'd made didn't make much sense, but I wasn't in politics, nor did I want to be. Lester didn't have a place to go. Junior had me call Ava. I was talking about his mama, Ava Cox, a local attorney. She rushed to the campground, and you know Dottie. The three of us laughed. She had no idea who was driving so fast up the campground. I smiled. I couldn't get the images out of my head of Dottie running down the road of the campground toward my camper van with her red hair snugged up in those hot pink curlers, cigarette smoke rolling out of her mouth, with her fuzzy house coat and matching slippers on. She looked like she was on fire. Ava took Junior home and left me there with Dottie, who was in major disbelief. I was shocked, too. Never in a million years did I ever think Lester or Grady Jr. would be pardoned. This is like one of those crime show stories that are so hard to believe. Dawn's brows lifted. She slowly shook her head and took a sip of the steaming hot coffee. It was crazy. Dottie had a million questions because she was hot on the cell phone, calling Al Hemmer. I groaned, talking about Normal's sheriff. Lester had all the paperwork, and he was in street clothes, but super thin, and just looked ill. I heard he has cancer. Abby pulled her foot onto the seat of the kitchen chair and hugged her bent leg. Betts is taking care of him, and happily. She is. She's been taking him to treatment, though he'd resisted treatment at first. From what I understood, there wasn't a cure, but Lester and Betts were still God-fearing people who believed in miracles. Betts keeps saying a mustard seed of hope. Still, it's crazy he showed up at your place. Dawn looked down the hall when she heard someone walking. Mary Elizabeth stopped at the door and placed her hands on her hips.
What do y'all think you're doing? Sitting around like this when we have a Thanksgiving dinner to fix for the 15 guests.
She stuck her leg out wider.
Well, get up.
Was she like this when you were growing up? Dawn teased. Worse. I stood up and wrapped my arms around Mary Elizabeth, giving her a nice hug before I went back to my egg-shelling job. But I love her.
If you love me so much, you will set a wedding date before I die,
she muttered just loud enough for all of us to hear her. Before you die, I rubbed my thighs. Before I die, my legs are killing me. How is that going? Abby asked and picked up her coffee to take a sip. She looked so cute in her long brown pigtails. Abby was the librarian at the Normal Public Library, and most days, she literally played the typical idea of how a librarian was portrayed with her hair pulled up in a tight bun or a swinging ponytail.
I'm not sure, but I think Christine is very much enjoying the fact I'm having a hard time keeping up.
I was joking about Christine Watson. She was the owner of the Cookie Crumble, and it was a well-known fact that I did enjoy her cookies very much. Too much. When she dropped off the weekly cookies for the hospitality room at Happy Trails Campground, I did sneak a few of them to my camper so I could enjoy one daily with my own coffee. This time of the year especially, she made seasonal cookies, and hers were to die for. They came at a cost, calories and sugar. Not that I cared too much about gaining some weight, but I still had this image of me in a wedding dress since I was a teenager that didn't include me holding the cookie from the Cookie Crumble. So, to offset any unwanted health issues and have my cookie too, I'd taken Christine up on her offer to join her running group.
Little did I know they were training for the upcoming Turkey Trot, a local 5K run where the proceeds went to local food banks, which was a much-needed charity around here. You've been running for a month or two now. Dawn leaned back with both hands around her mug. Each morning, they make the run longer and longer. Don't get me started on the extra night runs. I sighed and looked at the clock. Which I told Christine I'd meet her at the Cookie Crumble for an afternoon jog, so we can all meet up at the Red Barn tonight. Yes, Bobby Ray is excited. He said he'd met a lot of new guys that hung out with Joel. Abby was referring to Joel Grassel, the owner of Grassel's Garage, the local filling station and mechanic. Bobby Ray worked for Grassel's Garage, and they'd become good friends. People around here are crazy about tonight's tradition. Mary Elizabeth could tell we were all about to leave, so she filled up our cups of coffee. It was her way of nonchalantly keeping us there by telling us we had to finish our coffee. She didn't want us to leave, even though she was busying herself by cleaning up the mess we'd made from all the pre-cooking we'd done. A few of my guests are in town just for tonight. She wiped down the kitchen counter and turned the water faucet on to clean out the dish rag before she wrung it out, laying it over the edge of the sink. Hank is too. I knew the annual reunion of locals coming in for the Thanksgiving holiday was a long-standing tradition held at the Red Barn restaurant. According to Hank, for years, everyone gathered there, talking about old times, good times, catching up, and it was something they all looked forward to. No matter what year they graduated from the local high school, they all gathered. This was the first year I was able to go, and Hank was excited to introduce me to some of his friends who were coming into town that had long moved away. So getting in one of those extra runs with Christine made me feel like I could enjoy some of the great appetizers and a drink or two while Hank showed me off. I snickered at the thought. Chapter 2. Thanksgiving was my favorite holiday. The day would be spent around people who had made my life amazing and full. The people I love and who love me. Most of them weren't family. They were friends. Mary Elizabeth had already decided she would host a separate Thanksgiving for the guests a few days earlier, so she could host a huge Thanksgiving for our friends and family on the grounds of the milkery. With the snow in the forecast, I wasn't sure what Mary Elizabeth had planned, and she didn't even acknowledge the possibility when I asked her. Instead of worrying about it, I was going to let myself go with the flow, just as she appeared to be doing, but the weather was far from rain. How was Mary Elizabeth? Christine Watson asked. She stood at the glass display counter, my eyes fixated on the rows of freshly baked cookies, muffins, and cakes, but my ears were open to listening to her. She was good. The milkery bed and breakfast is fully booked, so that makes her happy. Not the income part, but the feeling like she's got people to take care of. I looked up and watched Christine as she held a cookie sheet in one hand while using the spatula in the other hand to put the cookies on another bacon tray resting on the cooling rack. You will have to try this one. The smile on her face made all the freckles across her nose expand. She put the tray down and tugged the hairnet off her head, letting her brown hair flow around her shoulders. Dirty chai donuts. Oh my goodness. I had to swallow all the saliva from just hearing the name. What on earth is in them? The name sounded scary, but they looked amazing. Ginger? Chai mix, of course. Cinnamon? She continued to rattle off all the ingredients just as though it were everyday language that I understood. But it amazed me how she could throw these spices together to make something that not only tasted so good, but also looked pretty. Her voice trailed off as she pushed through the swinging door from the shop into the kitchen. I'm grabbing my shoes, I heard her say as I paced back and forth, listening to the other customers order from one of Christine's employees. Christine and her sister Mallory owned the Cookie Crumble. When they first opened the location here in Normal, Mallory was here a lot. Then they opened the one in Slade, Kentucky. It was going so well, Mallory worked there full-time, and now Christine was here full-time. Are you ready? She came out totally transformed in her black running shorts, short-sleeved shirt, and bright pink running shoes. I got a glimpse of my reflection in the display case glass, making a note to stop by the Tough Nickel thrift shop to see what Buck might have in the way of running things. I am. I let go of a heavy sigh. That was a mighty big sigh. She nodded out the door, where a few of the other runners from the group had stopped on their run to pick us up along the way.
You're doing great.
She pushed out the front door, and I followed her.
Who's doing what?
Will Denning, Christine's longtime friend and the person in charge of the running group, stood there with his knee bent behind him. He had a hold of his shoe and stretched the front of his thigh.
I was telling May that for a beginner, she's been doing great.
Christine and a few of the others did their routine stretching to get them ready for the few-mile run ahead of us.
Is something going on?
Will asked. He was a physical trainer for the school sports and at a local nursing home, so he knew a few things about muscles and cramping. I thought after a few months of this, my thighs would stop hurting at some point. I bent over and rubbed them.
Have you been doing the lunges like we talked about?
He asked and put his hands on his waist, gliding down into front lunges.
Come on, it'll help.
He gestured for me to mimic him. Instead of just me doing it, the entire group did it.
See, we've got you.
He smiled and led a few more leg stretches before he darted off like a jet. The rest took off after him, leaving me and Christine lagging behind.
Really?
I kept pace with her.
You go on and join them. I'll be fine.
No way!
The sound of her feet hit the pavement and married the sound of the crickets and the chirping birds along the curvy road of the Daniel Boone National Forest.
We're in this together. Tonight we can all talk about running and make people roll their eyes.
Huh?
I got enough breath to question what she was talking about.
The Red Barn reunion. You're going, right?
Christine was able to talk, ask questions, focus on a conversation, and not miss a beat or slow down. Her breath didn't even change. I, on the other hand, had a hard time comprehending anything but sucking and gasping for air.
Oh, yeah.
I had to mentally wrap my head around her question, focus on it while trying to keep my feet on the pavement, and not venture off the cliff on each side of the road.
Hank is pretty excited about seeing some old high school friends who are coming into town.
The sun was high in the sky, and my thoughts drifted to the campground, where I could see Dottie savoring that afternoon cup of coffee, snuggled up in one of the Adirondack chairs near the lake, with a blanket over her legs to ward off the day's chill. She was talking to the guests who were just coming back from their afternoon hike on the trails surrounding Happy Trails.
If only I didn't love your donuts so much,
I grumbled.
What?
Christine asked. She was a couple of steps ahead of me.
Did you say something about donuts? I should be at the campground with a cup of coffee and a donut right now,
I called, and noticed the group ahead had veered off the blacktopped road and down into the woods.
What are we doing?
I asked when I didn't know why we were going off the road.
I'm not built to do trail running.
Trail running and trail hiking were two very different things. My body was barely built for the hiking, and even then, I was liable to trip on the roots sticking up out of the ground. Could you imagine Mary Elizabeth's face if I fell and broke something? Possibly not healing for months? She'd get put into a treatment facility for a nervous breakdown due to the fact I'd gone and hurt myself doing something I wasn't meant to do. Trail run.
It will help with endurance for the next couple of days, leading up to the turkey trot.
Was it bad that I found her being a little breathy made me the slightest bit happy? Up ahead, Will stood in the small space next to a tree and jogged in place, watching everyone run past.
Are y'all okay back here?
He directed his question at me and Christine, but his eyes were focused solely on me.
She's great,
I got out before I sucked in another deep breath.
Me, on the other hand, is iffy,
I teased, but it opened the door for him to continue to carry on the conversation while he jogged behind me.
Running on the uneven trails is really good for glutes and quads.
He was using his education as a physical therapist to give me all the details I didn't care about.
You'll also gain remarkable balance that'll not only help you with a nice core, but you'll need it to walk down the aisle.
He snickered and let me know in his own little way that I was only doing this running thing to keep in the same shape I was in, so I didn't go on one of those silly diets, like most women I knew who had gotten engaged would do.
All joking aside, using trails as an obstacle will make you stronger all over.
He gave his last-ditch effort to get me to buy into this whole running thing before he darted off past me and the rest of the group to take his place back as the leader. Instead of concentrating on my watch and how much longer we had until we came out on the other side of the trail, I decided to focus on my surroundings. which was no different than my volunteer position at the National Parks Committee, where it was my job to check out trails hikers would discover while they were visiting the Daniel Boone National Park. Most of them turned out to be deer trails, the kind where deer would walk a path day in and out, making it appear as an actual mapped trail for hikers. It was those types of trails that would lead hikers to accidents or even untimely deaths. The wind echoed from afar as it glided through the leaves of the big forest trees. On a regular walk and hike, the breeze would have brought goosebumps with it and landed them along my skin. Not today. Nary a goosebump was going to show up on the stream of sweat going down my legs as the heat from the run pulsed through my veins. The scurrying of squirrels caught my peripheral vision as they appeared to be desperately darting about to find nuts before the upcoming snow. It was fascinating how the animals in the forest knew when the seasons were changing, and I was lucky enough to be part of it. We took a sharp curve of the trail. The forest and caverns were wide open where the leaves had fallen off the forest trees, making me very aware of the cliff drops on either side of me. "Stay on the path," I repeated in my head and tried not to get lost in the trickling sound of the creek down below. Though it was a dangerous stretch to hike, it was even more treacherous to run, and I wanted to eventually have everyone come to my wedding, not my funeral. "What's wrong?" Christine turned around, jogging in place after she realized I wasn't running. Granted, I was walking at a fast pace, but not running. "Are you okay?" A concerned look fell over her face as she jogged back toward me. "I'm good. Just not going to make y'all come to a funeral instead of my wedding." I sounded like I was joking to her, but in reality, I wasn't comfortable jogging on a trail that I would deem to be difficult to hike, much less run. "You go on ahead," I encouraged her. "I'll catch up." "Are you sure?" she asked. "I'll catch up at Red Barn." I made myself even more clear as to when I'd see her. "If you're sure," she looked at me for some confirmation. I gestured to her to go ahead, and she took off. I walked even slower and kept my ears peeled, waiting for their feet pounding the rock-solid ground to move away from me before I sat down on a rotted log covered with green moss and a few fungi-style mushroom-looking creatures, so I could not just catch my breath, but take in the scenery. This was what brought tourists to our little town and filled up the campground. The landscape of the Daniel Boone National Forest. Though I'd been calling this place home for a few years, there were still many trails of the over 700,000 acres of land I'd yet to explore. This was one of them. Normally, I stuck close to the trails located in downtown Normal, Happy Trails, or even the old train station motel, so I knew those fairly well, but not on this side of town, where the Cookie Crumble was located, which was more in the business district of town. Christine had wanted to get closer to the hub of the tourists, but when she opened the Cookie Crumble, the building they were in now was the only one available at the time. I'd yet to see a business downtown go out of business or leave, so it could make room for other shops. Though I did keep my eyes peeled for anything that came through the park's office. My heart returned to its normal beat, and my breathing steadied. There was no denying that the feeling I'd hear runners talk about, Christine called it the runner's high, was a thing. I looked out over the cliff as I sat there, and a feeling of gratitude swept over me. This was something the scene alone would do to a person, but today, the feeling overtook me more than I'd expected. A smile curled my lips. My heart felt so much lighter as the shadow from the sun passed over a part of the mountainous terrain, almost hiding the naked trees, but lighting up the leaves that had yet to fall, where they'd make a color-quilted blanket on the trails for the runners to jog on. Cracks, groans, and even a few limbs breaking told me I wasn't alone. The critters were very aware I was there. I let the sounds fill me up and kept my eyes closed. I put my hands down on the log and stretched my legs out to let the last bit of the sun beating down on this particular spot cover my face and warm it now that it was chilled from the dried sweat. Mary Elizabeth popped into my head. I could hear her now. "You're gonna catch the flu, running around in this cold weather with shorts and a t-shirt on." Even as a teen, on days like this, Mary Elizabeth would make me put on a sweater or a coat. I opened my eyes and turned when I noticed a squirrel about 2 feet away had something in its mouth that didn't look like a nut. He scurried off when I pulled my legs back in, dropping the object. I can't stand when people litter, I grumbled and pushed myself up to get the trash the squirrel had brought to my attention. I'd learned you don't just pick up everything you see at first, but to bend down and get a look at it, to see if you need to use something between your hand and the object. Hmm, I hummed after I'd squatted down to take in the laminated photo with the tiny hole that had been ripped in the top. I flipped it over and realized it was one of those laminated cards the local funeral home passed out during a funeral service. I also noticed the squirrel had stopped to see what I was going to do with it. Someone probably brought this guy's ashes out here and scattered them. I shook the small card at the squirrel. Which you can't legally do. I stood there reading about the young man in the photo. Theodore Redford loved everything about nature. He loved to hike, kayak, swim, fish, and hunt. But his most enjoyable times were spent in the woods, hanging out with his best friends. I read out loud to the squirrel. The little fuzzy-tailed creature stood up on his hind legs, his little hands crossed in front of him, and stared at me like he was really interested in Theodore's obituary. Theodore had a prodigious appetite that was always the highlight of any family meal or the normal diner, where there was a meal named in his honor. This piqued my interest, since I loved eating at the normal diner and couldn't wait to find out from Ty Randall just who this Theodore was. Theodore was a kind man with a tender heart who always enjoyed connecting with people and who touched a lot of people's lives through his kind, unassuming nature. My voice trailed off. I turned the card back around to look at his photo, then flipped it back over to see that Theodore's life was not long, just 17 years old when he died. Was he your friend? I asked the squirrel. The squirrel had lost interest in me and darted down the trail, where I watched him almost take a dive off the trail and down the cliff. Something shimmered, catching my eye. I walked over and bent down, carefully moving the fallen leaves out of the way to uncover what was glittering. A cross. I uncovered the small wooden cross that was buried into the ground. There was a metal thumbtack where the two pieces of sticks met to make the cross. I bet you went right here. I held the laminated photo up to the thumbtack, knowing the hole in the top of the photo was an exact match. The cross was buried far enough that it wasn't going to come out of the ground without a little tugging. So I plucked off the thumbtack and made a new hole in the photo with it before I pushed it back in place. The runner's high I'd been feeling had quickly gone away when I realized this was probably the spot where the young man had died. There were a lot of these makeshift markers placed by family and friends when their loved ones succumbed to the treacherous dangers of the forest. The forest was a gorgeous place to come and visit, but would take you out in a literal heartbeat if you didn't respect it. Theodore Redford. I whispered his name to remember so I could look up this young man, who died not too long before I'd moved to town. A chilly breeze swept along the trail, rattling a few dried leaves in its path, before it landed on my legs, where the goosebumps let me know they'd arrived. Chapter 3. You didn't finish the trail run? Christine Watson held a small highball glass in her hand, sucking the clear liquid through a straw. Actually, I sat down to take in the gorgeous views, because you and I both know while running on a trail, you have to be careful and not fall off those cliffs. I stood at one of the tables near the stage, where the owners had cleared a few sit-down tables so people could stand while listening to the local band, Blue Ethel and the Adolescent Farm Boys. Plus, they knew tonight was going to be packed due to the fact it was the night everyone who came into town for Thanksgiving week was going to be here for the annual reunion.
I don't know why y'all'd want to do something like that to yourself.
Dottie Swaggart's nose curled in disgust.
You could at least smile every once in a while like you were enjoying it. Next time you see someone running,
she wagged her finger at us,
I want you to take a good, hard look at them. Are they smiling?
Her head shook side to side, her lips turned down. The lines around them from her years of smoking deepened.
They look miserable.
Her southern twang made the already long word twice as long.
She's right, you know. Abby elbowed me. She had the same drink as Christine, and the only reason I knew was because they had the same festive sprig of thyme, along with an apple slice as a garnish.
Look at your brother. She threw a chin. He acts like he went to school with all of Joel's friends.
Bobby Ray was right up in the middle of Joel Grassel and a bunch of his high school friends as they threw darts in what looked to be a heated game with all the hooting and hollering they were doing. I'm glad he's enjoying himself. I was going to bring up the photo of Theodore to Christine, but she'd walked off when she recognized someone from the past. Through the crowd and now the turned down overhead lights, I could see she and the man were having an intense conversation. But my attention was quickly diverted when Hank Sharp walked into the restaurant. It was like my heart and his heart had a string connected. Our eyes met from far across the restaurant. Both of us smiled at the same time. Mine faltered when Ellis Sharp, Hank's sister, walked up behind him.
"What on God's green earth is she doing with him?"
Dottie asked in a nasty tone, which was what I felt when I saw Ellis. It was like the spotlight had turned and shone right on the tall blonde bombshell. I swear all the men on the dance floor, near the dartboard and the pool tables, all took off like a bat out of hell to get to her side. At least she'll be too busy with the man to put her nose into my business. I grabbed Abby's drink from her hands and took a big gulp. Say, this is really good. It's an autumn fizz just for tonight's special. Abby wiggled her brows. I'll go get us another one.
Make it three.
Dottie held up three fingers, surprising me.
What? I like to tie one on every now and then. And tonight, it looks like we're gonna need to tie on a few.
I pinched a smile and looked across the barn at the transformation. It was an old working barn with stalls, hayloft, and all the livestock before it was brought back to life as a fancy restaurant that could turn into a honky-tonk on a dime. Long gone were the old stalls, haylofts, and dirt floor. The inside was completely open with exposed wooden beams. Each ceiling beam had strands of small round light bulbs, which were bright enough so you could see what you were eating, but were dimmed to induce the feeling that you were under the moon. Soon they'd turn the restaurant into the most romantic place to eat for the winter by hanging snowflakes from the ceiling and placing several small Christmas trees around. But for tonight, the white tablecloth linens and little candlelight lantern centerpieces were stored and replaced with bluegrass music, loud chatter, flying darts, and flying beer bottles.
Someone is gonna pay!
Dottie jerked around when a beer bottle whizzed by her head.
If that had hit me, I'd be all up in someone's crawl right now.
She stomped just as another one smashed against the wall closest to us. Screaming ensued, and a rumble like I'd never seen before stumbled right in front of our table, clearing the dance floor and causing Ethel Biddle to stop singing. The band's instruments faded, but not Otis Gullet. He was so into his fiddling, he'd not recognize the pile of men had taken the spotlight off of his fiddle playing. Otis didn't even skip a string with his bow. He was a-getting it, and by the way the crowd was cheering on the WrestleMania, Otis had to have thought they were having a good time due to his fiddle playing, until Ethel Biddle pushed him off the stage when the two men's bodies were flung up on the stage. It was a little too close for comfort for me and the rest of the gals.
Leave them!
I hollered at Dottie when I turned to her gathering up all the cocktail glasses from our table.
Leave them!
I ran back to get her, just as Hank came out of nowhere and lifted her up in the air, cradling her in his arms. It was like one of those hunky firefighter movies where he sweeps the woman off her feet in order to save her from a raging fire. The kind where the woman's hair was long and flowing and her lipstick was perfectly in the lines and not a smudge of makeup out of place, even though there was a raging inferno behind her. In this case, Dottie was crying. She had a death grip around Hank's neck. The edges of her hot red hair were standing on end. The mascara streamed down her face. Her red lipstick was smudged all around her lips and had reached her chin, and the unlit cigarette stuck between her teeth. Hank, he still looked good, even with Dottie hanging off him.
My, oh my.
Dottie tried to get herself together after Hank put her down outside in the parking lot of the red barn.
If I was Maybelline, I'd done dragged you down the aisle and never let you leave that camper.
Even in the dark, I could see Hank's face redden.
You are one fine specimen.
Dottie ran her fingernail down his bicep, though it was completely covered in his plaid shirt. That's enough. I moved Dottie in the stream of the parking lot lights to get a look at her. Are you all right?
Fine as Otis's fiddle playing.
Her face was turned to Hank. She made kissy faces at him. I took my fingers and moved her jaw to face me.
What? He knows I'm teasing. But I ain't teasing you.
She wagged her finger at me.
You need to get that man down the aisle, or someone is gonna sweep him out from under you.
I think we are fine, I assured her, though I did see he was talking to Natalie Willoughby, a former citizen of Normal, who was probably in town for the Red Barn Restaurant annual reunion.
Are you now?
Dottie's sarcastic tone didn't go unnoticed, but luckily, my facial expression was because Abby and Bobby came running over to make sure we were okay.
Did you see them almost whack me with a beer bottle?
I knew I had some time to meander over Hank's way, because Dottie would be telling the story for months, if not years, to come. I could hear her now, talking about how two drunk men ruined the Red Barn Restaurant's annual informal citizen reunion. Oh, Hanky Panky, you look like a hero carrying someone from a burning fire, I heard Natalie tell Hank. I rolled my eyes so hard, I swore I could see my brains. You must have seen the same movie I did, because I said that exact same thing. I made sure I placed my hand, engagement ring shining, flat on his chest. I'm a lucky gal. Mm-hmm. Natalie's hum came from deep inside because her lips were pinched tight. There you are. Ellis nearly fell into the middle of the group with a bottle of wine in her hands. I mean, we almost died in there. Alice was good at stretching the truth of many things, this being one of those. Did you see Hanky Panky's ring he gave to my soon-to-be sister-in-law, who has yet to nail down a date for my poor brother? Alice was drunk. She threw her arm around my neck, and the wine bottle tipped over, pouring down not only on Hank, but also me. Whoopsie, she cackled, removing her arm from around me and throwing her hand up to cover her smiling mouth. Even drunk, Ellis looked pretty. She stood a little taller than me, just enough so that certain clothes looked frumpy on me, but anything she wore looked as though it was tailored especially for her. She positioned one arm across herself with the wine bottle dangling from her hand. Her rosy complexion was perfect for her job as a model. But the drunk rosy complexion was really pretty, too. She wore a smirk on her face that fit her attitude. Her thin shape was accentuated under the tight black pants and tight black turtleneck, which made her features even more striking. Her blonde hair was straight and loose. It was a great style for tossing, which she did with every gesture she made. I heard. Congratulations. Natalie, though she didn't mean it, did seem a little embarrassed for Alice. She took a quick look at my hand that was now at my side before she realized I'd seen her. Can I see? She put her hand out.
It was my Granny Agnes's.
Hank's voice was so tender and loving. He put a hand on the small of my back and used the other to wipe down his shirt where Ellis had spilled the wine. Oh, Hanky Panky. Ellis continued to use his childhood nickname, the one he didn't like, but with Ellis, he tolerated it. I'm so sorry. I hope you can get that out of your plaid shirt, she snickered. Ellis and I had our differences, but had put those behind us. But when it came to Natalie, Ellis had tried her hardest to break us up and set them up. I wasn't sure how it had all gone down, but when Hank and I had broken up, there'd been some rumors of him and Natalie going on a few dates. I wasn't sure how accurate the gossip was, due to the fact Hank had moved away from Normal. And Natalie had also left to take a coroner's job, since she was the assistant coroner to Colonel Holtz. It's very pretty. She dropped my hand and pushed her hands into the pockets of her jeans. I bet Agnes was very happy. Though I wanted to think Natalie wasn't being sincere. She was, or at least she appeared to be. And then I knew she was, because one of the rowdy men came over with his rhinestone button-down shirt tucked into skin-tight jeans with a huge belt buckle and a set of cowboy boots on him that he'd no way gotten here in Normal.
Hank, man, how the hell are you?
He swung an arm around Natalie before he slammed a hand slap on Hank's arm. He dragged the sleeve of his shirt across his bloody lip and smiled like a big doofus.
I'm good, Garrett.
Hank gave a half smile. Immediately, I could tell he didn't care for the guy. That was when I found myself not listening to anything they said, because my crazy mind went directly to wondering if Hank was a wee bit jealous this guy had his arm around Natalie. I cleared my throat.
I'm sorry, man.
Hank did the guy lingo.
I'm rude. This is my fiancée, Mae.
Wee doggy, you got you a good one.
Garrett winked at me from underneath the cowboy hat, making the air around us a little more nippy than it really was. Flashing lights lit up the darkness that had covered the night sky. They were quickly followed by the sirens.
Looks like they done went and called the law.
Garrett snuggled Natalie closer to him and gave her a kiss on top of her head.
Now, don't you worry about me. I'll go talk to the sheriff, and I'll see you back at the bed and breakfast.
I'll wait. Natalie grabbed a hold of him, fearful-like, a side of her I'd never seen.
Suit yourself.
Garrett snickered and looked at me and Hank.
If Mitchell Redford don't stop running that mouth of his, we'll be doing this again tomorrow night.
Garrett pointed his finger at the restaurant and moseyed over to Al Hemmer's sheriff's truck.
So, you and Garrett Callis?
Hank shuffled his foot.
How did that happen?
I was out to dinner one night, and who would walk in but Garrett? You know, when you're in a new town and see someone familiar, it's kinda nice. Natalie told her story to Hank, while I gawked at Garrett, dramatically explaining to Al his side of the brawl. Strange, because you know I love all of nature. I had no idea where she was going with this. Naturally, since I grew up here. But Garrett's mom has this amazing greenhouse. A couple, in fact. They're crazy big, and I never knew about it. She laughed, dragged her empty ring finger up to the necklace around her neck, and fiddled with it in a flirty way. I curled my hand around Hank's elbow. Her eyes took in my movement. They moved up to my face, and she pinched a grin. Anyways, we've spent the past couple of days helping her water, fertilize, and prune the plants she has in there while they're out of town for the holidays. It's amazing, really. Her hand fell from the chain, and she clasped them in front of her. You know, May, I was telling Garrett about the milkery, and I think Mary Elizabeth would love to have some of his mom's products to sell. Is that right? My face stilled as I gave her a blank stare. She stiffened at my response.
Maybe.
Hank leaned back and smiled at me.
We can ask her at Thanksgiving, but she might already have someone for the upcoming spring. You know, businesses plan things like those months ahead of time. Mary Elizabeth, well, she's always a season ahead.
Hank gave a nervous ramble.
He's the one who should be arrested. He killed my cousin.
One of the sheriff's deputies had dragged out the other guy, who I was assuming to be Mitchell Redford. I shifted my gaze to Christine Watson, Will Denning, and a few of the other runners from the running group, who were also standing in a circle, watching what was going on. I have no idea what that was all about in there. One minute we were dancing and enjoying talking to everyone. Then, out of nowhere, Mitchell Redford and Harrison Pierce started making trouble. Natalie threw an eye over to the sheriff, where two other men stood next to Al Hemmer and Garrett. All three men looked heated, and Al was trying to keep the peace by putting his hand up between them. But when they started throwing punches, not only was Al's hand knocked out of the way, Al was pummeled by Garrett's fist. Garrett! Natalie screamed and ran over to him, but she didn't get there fast enough. The deputies cuffed him and threw him in the back of one of their sheriff's cars. Natalie beat on the window. I'll come down there! No, I'm coming! She hollered after the car as it took off with the swirling lights and whirling siren. Here's your phone! She held the cell phone up in the air as she tried to break through the police barricade, but she didn't make it in time.
Maybe that'll whack some sense into Al.
Dottie was serious. Go help her. I flung a finger at Natalie and instructed Hank.
Why me?
He gave me an awkward look. Because that's what you do. I gave him a little shove to get him moving. Reluctantly, he wandered over as Dottie darted straight toward me.
What on earth is he doing?
Dottie took a draw off her cigarette. The tip lit up like the butt end of a lightning bug. You said he was a hero. He's going to be a hero. I smiled when I saw Natalie melt into his chest.
Not her hero, Maybelline.
Dottie's words hit me as the clouds in the fall night sky parted, the moon peeking out and its beam spotlighting the look on Natalie's face. A look I'd recognized from the many times she tried to get her sweet southern claws into my hanky-panky. There was a lot of ums, and elbowing from Dottie through the pack of cigarettes she'd gone through while we stood there waiting for Hank. Only he wasn't alone.
Natalie's purse is in Garrett's car, and she can't get into her parents' house without her keys.
Hank was explaining to me with kid gloves on.
I need my keys.
Natalie's jaw clenched as she interrupted Hank.
Hank is the only person I know who can jimmy a car door to unlock it. The sheriff deputies said they don't have those tools, and no one has a hanger, not even in the restaurant.
Not a wire hanger. They have others.
Hank continued to explain further to me when he honestly just needed to cut to the chase.
I have some back at the camper. That solves it.
Dottie threw her cigarette on the ground and snuffed it out.
Let's go home. See you next time you're in town, Natalie.
You can't leave me here. I have no ride,
Natalie whined.
Hank said he'd go get a hanger.
Yes.
This time, he stopped her from talking and turned his attention directly to me.
You and Dottie can follow me and Natalie back to the campground. I'll grab a hanger and bring her back here to unlock it, then give her a ride back to her parents.
There will be no such doings.
Dottie wagged her finger in Hank's face.
Me and Natalie will sit right here while you and Maybelline drive to the campground to get the hanger.
You don't need to do that. We can all go.
Natalie's eyes narrowed.
Come on, Hank. I'll ride with you just like we planned.
I think Dottie's plan is great. I grabbed Hank by the hand and pulled him toward his car, even though I had driven me and Dottie here.
We will be back in a flash.
I'll go with you, Natalie called after us.
No, you won't either. You'll stay right here with me.
I overheard Dottie and couldn't help but snicker. There was so much tension in the car when Hank and I had driven back to the campground, it was almost hard to breathe.
Fine, I'll go first. Why are you mad?
I asked Hank, thankful the darkness had covered us and he couldn't see my set jawline.
I'm not mad. I guess I'm confused.
Though I couldn't see him, I could hear him suck in a deep breath.
Confused? I asked.
You don't want me to talk to Natalie. Then you want me to rescue her. It's confusing what you want me to do and not be mad at me.
He laughed.
Damned if I do, damned if I don't.
I know it's confusing, and it's conflicting to me too.
I reached over and grabbed his hand that was resting on his thigh.
But I have the ring and the man, so I don't mind you helping her anymore. She's a trigger to how she treated me and the underhanded things she did when you weren't my fiancé.
I said it in a teasing way.
I love you and only you, so if you want me to help her, I will. But other than that, she never crosses my mind.
Hank turned into the campground. The small posts with the solar-powered lights dimly lit up the drive leading up to the campground, where several campfires glowed from the hot embers with occupied chairs around the fire rings. It was a funny thing in the campground. Everything started and came to life around 7 p.m. due to the nature of the sun having long set and the darkness filling in the space. Also around then, the campers would have gotten in from any sort of hiking or day activities and gotten their grills fired up or coals lit. Everyone was respectful of everyone else. I rolled down the truck window and gestured for Hank to drive the long way around so I could check on everyone. There were a few of our guests intermingling, which was the most special part for me. It was times like this when they gather to learn about each other and share information or knowledge they might have about camping, or even discussing different campgrounds they'd visited around the many national parks in the States. There was different music coming from a few different sites. One of the campers had their radio on and was sitting around their fire with some holiday beverages, when the next camper had a man strumming on his guitar and a woman playing a harmonica.
I wish we'd just stayed here tonight,
Hank said and looked over at me.
This is our party, right here.
Yeah, I agreed. I do miss it when we aren't here.
Maybe we should get married here. I mean, look at that.
Hank's headlights flashed on the backdrop of the Daniel Boone National Forest.
I know we can't see the colors right now in the dark, but can you imagine what kind of photo that'd be?
Just when I didn't think I could love you anymore.
I used my hand to extend the seatbelt across my shoulder and leaned over to kiss him.
I think you've had a great idea.
He parked the truck, but kept it running in front of his camper when we got around the campground. I sat there waiting for him and thought about a campground wedding.
Who on earth would have thought I'd have my wedding at a campground?
I talked to myself with a giggle. Then I thought about Mary Elizabeth.
Lordy, help me.
Hank hurried out of the fifth wheel with a wire hanger in his hand.
What's with the smile?
Hank asked when the overhead light in the truck illuminated. He put the hanger on the floorboard in the second seat of the truck and got his seatbelt on.
You make me happy.
I shrugged and knew no matter how much he helped Natalie tonight, I had nothing to worry about. One problem with that thinking? I'd not thought about what the rest of the week would bring.
Chapter 4.
You dropped her off at the milkery? Christine Watson asked on our early morning jog.
I mean, I saw her get in the car with you and Hank last night, but I figured you were taking her down to the station to get Garrett out of jail.
Nope. I couldn't believe the energy I had this morning. I would love to have thought it was the runner's high, but this was purely me getting my deep-rooted anger about Natalie using last night's situation to get Hank to go above and beyond the hero status I wanted him to play.
Garrett had told her to go to the milkery, where they are staying, and Mary Elizabeth didn't even tell me Natalie was staying there.
Christine and I had stayed up way past our bedtime to think about running with our usual morning running group. Or she was just being nice and agreed to run with me later in the morning, leaving the other runners to their usual early schedule. They weren't about to skip a day of training for the turkey trot this weekend, but I was hoping for a much easier run this morning since today was Thanksgiving, and I would be feasting on some delicious Mary Elizabeth turkey with all the fixins. But she seemed pretty upset after Garrett was taken to jail.
I was so glad we stayed on the road, even though we had to keep our eyes out for the heavier-than-usual traffic on the rural roads leading into downtown. I noticed Christine's sudden silence.
Do you know something about Garrett? I wanted to know all I could about Natalie and what appeared to be her boyfriend. At first, she was all into him and upset when he was put in the deputy's car after he slugged Al. I was figuring the fist to Al's little jaw wasn't meant for Al. But all the same, it wasn't good to hit the sheriff, even if the sheriff was Al Hemmer.
He's been gone for a long time from normal, so I don't really know him.
Christine talked as if we were sitting on a porch swing, having us a social conversation, not running at a faster clip than I'd prefer. But she was giving me all the details about Garrett, which tied to Natalie, who I didn't want any part of her woman claws in my hanky-panky.
He used to run around with a crowd of my friends. I'll say that I hope he's grown up a lot.
Notice she didn't say a little, telling me in no uncertain terms, Garrett Callis was a hellraiser back in the day.
That's certainly someone I didn't see Natalie with,
she finished as we rounded the big curve before the Red Barn restaurant off in the distance.
That tells me I need to give him the benefit of the doubt and believe he's grown up.
The sun started to inch up over the mountain, reminding me of one of those push-up sherbet pops with a plastic stick. But if you push too hard, the whole cardboard cylinder container of sherbet would pop up. That was how the sun was. Once it peaked, it popped. It was shining brightly, giving light to the activity going on in the parking lot of the restaurant.
Are they hosting some sort of free Thanksgiving dinner?
Christine asked when she too noticed the flurry of activity.
I think that's a great idea, but I don't think the sheriff would be there, or some deputies, or even Tucker Pyle's ranger truck, if that was the case.
I felt my legs pick up speed, almost sprinting toward the parking lot to get a look.
Besides, my breathing heaved out of my chest, causing my words to come out exhausted. Cokie Ogden is hosting a free Thanksgiving supper to anyone who wants to come to the barn.
The old train station motel had an events venue on the property. Since Cokie didn't have much family left, she was always hosting various things for the community, so people weren't left out during anything, including holidays.
Will and the running group are there, she pointed out and darted off, leaving me far behind.
The closer I got to the restaurant, the less focus I had on the ripening, vivid colors of red and orange of the mountain landscape that kept me going on my runs, turning instead to a yellow caution tape strung around the side of the restaurant, like the twinkling lights on all the campers at Happy Trails campground. I mean, it was hanging all over the place. My feet ached with each stride as it got bigger and bigger. The ache in my side got stronger and stronger until I finally noticed Colonel Holtz's hearse.
This ain't good.
I had slowed when the sudden realization someone was dead had pushed any sort of running right on out of my mind. Then it hit me even harder. It was like throwing kerosene on a fire. My adrenaline exploded, and I took off. Before I knew it, I was next to the running group,
albeit bent over with my hands gripping my knees and sucking in air as though it were through a straw, but I was there.
What? I sucked in a breath. Happened?
I let go of the breath, standing up and taking another deep inhale. Christine turned around. Her eyes were already red around the edges, and I noticed she was in a shocked, upset, emotional stage.
Christine?
I put a hand on her.
Who is it? I can't believe it.
The words coming out of her mouth matched the look on her face.
It's Mitchell Redford, the guy Garrett got into a fight with last night.
She gulped.
I'm sorry. Did you know him?
I asked, not sure whether to grab her in a huge hug or just let her be sad due to the nature of the shock we'd run up on.
Know him?
Will peered over Christine's head and looked at me.
She dated him for like 3 years.
Five.
She corrected him in a whisper before she buried her head into my shoulder.
5 years? I'm so sorry.
I patted her on the back with both arms around her. I tried to get a better look at the scene to see what happened, but Al had it pretty well cornered off and a sheet hung up.
How do you know it's Mitchell?
Colonel told us.
Will had his hands planted on his waist like the rest of the running group. They weren't standing still like me and Christine. Some had their arms up over their heads, stretching them out, knees bent as they stood on one leg, as if they were stretching out their muscles, but their eyes were fixated on the unfolding situation.
Did you talk to him last night?
I asked her, remembering her walking off to go talk to a guy last night, but I'd not gotten who it was until it clicked that this might be him. She did look awfully giddy and happy to be talking to him.
I talked to him for a long time last night.
She pulled away from me and wiped the tears off her face.
In fact, it was right before Garrett Callis started the fight.
The car. My jaw dropped, my head turned, and I knew I recognized the car, though it was in the daylight.
What? You know something?
Christine's nostrils flared. There seemed to be some anger coming out.
Tell me what you know. I know you, and how you always kinda know things, she demanded.
Last night, when Garrett was arrested, his car keys were in his pants pocket. Natalie couldn't get in the car to get her purse where her parents' house keys were to get in their house, even though I'm guessing she could have woken them up. But regardless, Hank had to come to her rescue and get the car door open. I left out the details of us having to go to the campground to grab a coat hanger in order for Hank to get the car doors unlocked. It was beside the point. That's the car.
We're going to take off now,
Will interrupted us.
Are you going to be okay?
I'll take care of her.
There was no need for anyone else to stay with Christine. I'd call Hank, and he could come to my rescue this morning.
We will get a ride home. I don't think she needs to be running. Yeah, y'all go on.
She looked at him and the group. All of them had very concerned looks on their faces for their friend.
May is here.
Okay, I hope to see you in the morning.
He said it as more of a question than a statement before he darted off.
May?
She said my name in a way that really got my attention.
Yeah?
I looked at her.
Do you think Garrett had something to do with Mitchell's death?
She asked.
Why would you say that?
I wondered if she knew something I didn't. And she did. Sorta.
When we were kids, Mitchell's cousin Ted was on a hike with us, and he fell to his death.
I blinked back into my memory of the hike from yesterday.
Wait, Theodore Redford?
She nodded.
The one who loved nature and...
I spouted out all the stuff I recalled from the obituary card.
The trail we were on yesterday?
She nodded again.
I was thinking about him the entire time, but didn't say anything because it was too sad to think about.
Both of us watched a little movement from behind the sheet Al had hung up, but there wasn't anything to be seen. When the sheet swayed a little, it drew our attention.
Mitchell always said Garrett pushed Ted off the trail to his death because they were arguing and both were hot-headed. Of course, we'd been drinking, so I never in a million years thought it was true. But last night, and now...
Her voice trailed off, giving way to silent tears. Colonel Holtz walked out from behind the sheet just as my phone chirped a text. I unzipped the fanny pack I wore when I went on these jogs and took my phone out. It was Dottie texting the laundry club ladies' group message that there'd been a murder at the Red Barn restaurant.
Murder?
I thought to myself, so as not to get Christine upset anymore.
Colonel is getting the gurney. Do you think he'll let me see Mitchell?
Another text chirped in from Bats, saying someone from the church had called Lester, though Lester wasn't a preacher of the normal Baptist church any longer and had been pardoned of his jail sentence. People here tended to overlook things. But in Lester's case, I could only imagine it was for the fact the man wasn't going to live much longer. And though he did the crime, he was still the man they loved, and in some weird way, found comfort in him. Queenie shot back a text, asking if we knew who it was, to which Abby responded she'd heard it was Garrett Callis, to which I replied with the correct name, Mitchell Redford, then took a quick photo of the Red Barn restaurant sign, minus the crime scene, to prove I was there. Then my phone rang, and it was Dottie. She wanted all the details. I was sure of it. I sent her to voicemail, saying I couldn't talk and would be home shortly. Then she sent me back a text that read she needed to talk to me now, right before my phone rang.
Shortly better be soon. Natalie Willoughby just drove past the office. I'm watching her pull up to Hank's camper as we speak, and he's sitting outside.
Dottie grunted. I knew she was getting a better angle to see out the office window. She would know Natalie's car, since Hank had been keeping his camper there, living in it, even while we were broken up.
He's just offered her his cup of coffee. Oh, she took it!
A shameful gasp expelled from her and through the phone. There was silence.
What, Dottie?
I found myself suddenly thrown into her shenanigans.
They went inside.
The excited tone in her voice took a shift, almost sounded as if she were sad for me.
We got a murder, huh?
Waldo Willie snuck up behind me. I swear he did. He snuck. If I'd seen him coming, I would have stopped him from talking since Christine was standing there, and she didn't yet know the particulars of Mitchell's death.
Is that Waldo?
Dottie's tone shifted right back up and pierced my ear. Dottie, I've got to go. I wanted to hurry off the phone. The quicker I got Christine out of here, the faster I could get back to the campground and see what was really going on inside of Hank's camper. I'll be back shortly, I said again.
Murder?
Christine's shoulders slumped.
Mitchell was murdered.
As she looked at me for some sort of confirmation, I watched as her eyes clouded with a hazy sadness.
I don't know.
I put a hand on her forearm. Waldo doesn't know. I gave Waldo the wonky eye, but he didn't get the point that I wanted him to shush.
You knew him?
Waldo had no couth about him.
How did you know him?
Honestly!
I stomped a foot and pointed to Christine when she ran off toward Colonel, no doubt wanting some answers to Waldo's claim.
What is that? The girlfriend? From my research, he didn't have a girlfriend.
Waldo flipped the pages of his notebook.
Did your research tell you he had friends? Good friends. And she was one of them? Or did your research tell you to have a little more compassion?
I shook my head and headed after my friend, even though I was sure I was taking out my frustrations with the fact my fiancé was having coffee with a woman who didn't give two cares in the world if her so-called boyfriend had killed someone.
How was I to know she was his girlfriend?
He asked and kept his eye on the fluid situation.
She's not his girlfriend anymore. I mean, for a long time, but in high school or something. Don't quote me. I don't know all the details.
I sighed and tried to make out what Christine and Colonel were saying to each other. By the way, Colonel was shaking his head and her face jutted up in his. She wasn't getting what she wanted, and that was to see the body.
Why do you say it was murder? I asked him.
Came through on the police scanner.
It wouldn't surprise me if Waldo kept the scanner running all day and all night.
I don't know how, but the sheriff's deputy who called it in said the runners found a dead body. When the deputy came, he called dispatch for backup so they could look around the area because he said it appeared to be a murder.
Hearing what Waldo had said, it was making sense with all the deputies scouring the scene and the surrounding area, probably looking for evidence. Then there was the door of the Red Barn restaurant propped open that I'd not noticed until now. There was literally nothing we could do here or help in any way. Al seemed to have it all under control, and he didn't even give me another glance to ask any questions.
It was good seeing you, Waldo. Have a happy Thanksgiving.
It took everything in me not to invite him to the Milkery for Thanksgiving supper tonight. But in light of what was happening before our eyes, I imagined he would be knee-deep in old newspaper articles and online research to find out anything and everything about Mitchell. Plus, it was Thanksgiving, not a time to discuss murders and those things. After I excused myself politely from Waldo, I walked over to Christine. "What did Colonel say?" I asked in hopes my assumptions were wrong. Waldo walked past us and took his own shot at getting some information from one of the sheriff's deputies.
"He couldn't confirm or deny who it is or how they died. He simply said there was a body."
The look of despair had taken her vibrant glow from the run completely away.
"I asked if it was a man or woman. He wouldn't even comment on it. I told him if they thought it was Mitchell, I could identify him."
"Why don't we leave, and I'll see what Hank can find out," I offered a sympathetic smile. "I'll call him to come get us." A few quick head nods and another swipe of her hand underneath her running nose. She agreed, and I dialed Hank's number. I was sent straight to voicemail. I redialed. Same thing.
"Well, ladies, it appears the law is being tight-lipped."
Waldo had sauntered on over.
"But I have a good reason to believe it's..."
"Waldo," I interrupted him, "can you drive us back to the cookie crumble? We don't feel like running, especially if a killer is on the loose."
"A killer?"
he questioned. "I don't know. I mean, the governor did pardon a lot of people over the last few months, and a few of them were in the clink for killing people." I shrugged in hopes it would spark an interest for him to go down the rabbit hole of checking out the prisoners who had been released. "Sometimes they get a little restless, antsy, fall back into their old ways."
"That's good."
He bit his lower lip and shook his ink pen at me.
"Yeah, they aren't going to tell me anything here. I don't even think they know. I'll get a little research done today, and then hopefully later get some detailed information about the murder."
"Stop saying that,"
Christine spit out. The stages of grief were starting to show, and the angry side of her was coming out.
"If, and I say if, it's Mitchell, and he was murdered, they are going to pay."
She left us standing there as she stomped toward Waldo's car.
"Oh, it's Mitchell, and he was murdered."
Waldo's words sent a terrifying chill to my heart. Chapter 5.
"Be back shortly?"
Dottie's brow ticked up. She stood in the grass between the campground's driveway and the lake, watching Fifi run around chasing the ducks back into the cold water of the lake.
"Shortly doesn't mean an hour later."
She slid her gaze past me, over my shoulder, to where Natalie's car was still parked on the concrete pad in front of Hank's fifth wheel. "I'm confident in my relationship that nothing is going on." I had a sick feeling that I was trying to convince myself, when in reality, the look in Natalie's eyes when she stared at Hank last night told me no matter how many Garrett calluses were in her life, she'd still have that one little piece in her heart for Hank.
"Then why does she need to come see him on Thanksgiving? And why has she been in there for over an hour?"
Dottie pulled out her cigarette case and batted out one of her smokes. "I don't know, but I've got to get the corn pudding made and get showered and ready before we head over to the milkery." I looked around the campground and saw some campers coming to life. Before they'd all checked in, I'd given them the flyer from Cokie Ogden about the communal Thanksgiving dinner she was hosting at the old train station motel, so they knew they had a place to go for Thanksgiving if they didn't already have plans. But now I was more grateful than ever Cokie did plan this, because a lot of people made reservations to eat at the Red Barn restaurant. Only today it would have been turned into the white tablecloth, fancy eating place it generally was, since last night was a special and traditional occasion for the locals. Now that it was a murder scene, or at least the rumblings of one, there was no way it would be cleared for them to open, leaving everyone out of a place to have their Thanksgiving meal.
"She must have seen you coming home."
Dottie pointed the lit cigarette at Natalie. She'd emerged from Hank's camper. She gave us a slight wave.
"Hey there, happy Thanksgiving."
Shocked, I looked at Dottie, my upper lip ticked up in the corner.
"What?"
Dottie asked with a smile on her face and a wave of her hand.
"Gotta be nice to girls like her. She thinks she's so fancy and all. But the only culture that woman will ever have is a yeast infection."
I snorted and smiled.
"See? I made you smile. Now wave like it's no big deal she's been alone with your man for an hour."
Dottie was good at making me laugh, and I did what she said. To say Natalie was taken aback by the smiles and waves was an understatement. When she smiled back at us, I could see the nervous quiver on her lips. Nervous, just the way I liked her. I heard Hank tell her goodbye and he'd be in touch. Like the southern gentleman he was, he opened her car door and then shut it once she was in.
I wish she'd shut that on her foot. Not enough to break it, but just hurt it a bit.
Dottie sucked on the cigarette and then let it go in a steady stream in front of her. We can't always get what we wish for. I sighed, since there Natalie was, in my face, in my campground, when I'd wished many, many times that she'd leave normal. Which she did, but here she was again. I should have added to my wish that she'd stay gone. Good for her that I'm in the holiday spirit of joy and love, that I don't have any issue with her. I clicked my tongue for Fifi to come and leave the ducks alone. I'll pick you up at 4.
Then you better get to baking the corn pudding. It takes a while.
She and I both looked back to the top of the campground when we heard another set of tires coming up the drive, to Natalie's tires leaving. It was Henry Bryant, my handyman. What is he doing here? I asked Dottie. An amused look covered my face, knowing good and well he was probably there to visit with her.
He called and said his plans to go to the Red Barn restaurant had been canceled. So I called up Mary Elizabeth and asked if she had room for one more.
Dottie refused to give an inkling she had a little something-something for Henry. Whatever you need to tell yourself to make you feel better about your feelings for him. I loved making her squirm when it came to the matter of her own heart.
Maybelline, you've lost your mind.
Oh, you can dish it, but you can't take it, I joked as she walked to the front of the campground to meet him.
Take what?
Hank walked up with Chester, which only made Fifi and Chester run off, chasing the ducks together. Nothing. I looked up at him and melted into those big green eyes that stood out against his black head of hair. What did Natalie want?
The guy Garrett had a fight with ended up dead. Garrett was released early this morning on his own, and the murder was placed an hour after he was released. Natalie said Al Hemmer came back to her parents' place looking for him when they went to the milkery. And Mary Elizabeth said he asked her for a ride back to the Red Barn to get his car. His car is still there, and now in sheriff's custody.
What does this have to do with you? I wasn't following what happened to Mitchell Redford had to do with Hank.
Natalie says Garrett didn't do it,
Hank said. Did he know something I didn't? Was Waldo right? Didn't do what? I questioned.
Have anything to do with what happened to Mitchell?
Hank's shoulders fell.
Natalie said when Al came by, they insinuated there was some foul play. They pulled some video this morning from the Red Barn's outside alarm camera, where it shows Garrett is there with Mitchell.
Foul play? I gulped. What exactly did Waldo know about this? He knew enough to be very confident in saying Mitchell was murdered. Did Natalie say what Al thinks?
No, Al didn't tell her. Garrett, he's disappeared. She wants me to investigate it.
Hank ran his hand through his hair.
I knew you weren't going to like it, but I told her I'd see what I could find out. Maybe Granny has some information.
Yeah, maybe. I wasn't about to touch all this with a 10-foot pole. Fifi, I called. She jerked up from the edge of the lake and looked back at me. Let's get a treat. Bribing the poor dog was the only way I could get her away from Chester. Chester also knew the word treat, so he also darted back to me.
Want help?
The way he looked at me, it was too hard for me to say no. Of course, you can open the cans of cream corn. I kissed him, and we walked back to my camper. I've been thinking about the wedding and who might be bridesmaids for me.
Yeah.
Hank smiled.
Let me guess. Bets, Abby, and Ellis?
Ellis? My eyes shot open. Luckily, I was opening the camper door and wasn't looking at him. I took the step up into the camper and walked over to the small pantry door.
Aren't the sisters of the groom always in the wedding?
He asked. I don't know, but I was talking about Dottie. I took out a couple cans of corn and cream corn. I planted a smile on my face before I turned around. But of course Ellis will be a bridesmaid. I gulped back the idea of her doing the worst thing you could do at a southern wedding, upstage the bride. Ellis would definitely have her model face on. And the fact she was there would upstage me anyways. But in order to keep the peace, I would do whatever it took to make Hank happy.
Wouldn't she be the maid of honor?
He asked. Dottie? My voice rose an octave.
No.
He moved behind me, brushing his fingers along the small of my back.
Alice?
He was in the cabinet underneath the sink, which told me he was getting the glass dish I needed for bacon. The lump in my throat that had Alice's name on it was getting much harder for me to swallow.
I've not thought that hard about it, but we can definitely talk. But I was talking about Dottie being a bridesmaid.
I choked down the lump.
Dottie?
He questioned.
She's a little old, don't you think? I mean, maybe she can keep the guest book or give out those little brochure thingies.
Old? I set the cans on the counter and reached for the jar of dog treats.
I didn't forget you two.
Fifi's toenails clicked on the floor as she danced in front of me. Chester's tongue was hanging out in anticipation. I handed them a treat each, and both ran to a different dog bed to eat them.
Is there an age limit on being a bridesmaid?
I asked, a little baffled by his response.
I don't know, May. I'm a guy, and the only weddings I've really been to are people who are young, I guess. I'm sorry. I think Dottie would make a great bridesmaid, though she might bedazzle her dress.
He brought up a topic I would definitely have to address with her.
Mary Elizabeth would die. I snickered at the thought, but at least I'm at the stage where I'm starting to think about things.
Well, what about a date?
He asked, and took the can opener out of the drawer while I took out the dry ingredients from the pantry.
Now you're pushing it,
I teased, and took out a recipe from my mama, my birth mama's. It was one of the few things that had been saved from the fire, and it was in her own handwriting, which I cherished so much.
But I am leaning more toward next fall.
We both love fall, and with Mary Elizabeth's planning style, I'm guessing she'll need that long to plan.
Hank knew this would warm the cockles of Mary Elizabeth.
You are a suck-up,
I teased him and followed it up with a kiss before we both started to make the corn pudding, which wasn't really that hard or too uncommon. It was the history and the memories I held inside that made this so special. I remembered her in our little house's kitchen where she made this on Thanksgiving. Mary Elizabeth had always been so good about it. She even insisted we make it every year, even though she didn't like corn. She made sure it was part of our annual Thanksgiving dinner. When I was a little older, she started having me make it on my own. She'd tell everyone who came, because she'd always had a very open invitation to anyone who needed or wanted to come for the holidays, how it was my mama's special dish, and she'd tell everyone how proud of me she was that I'd made it. Hank had embraced every single side of me, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Though I'd like to think the good outweighed the bad and ugly. What is your take on the whole Mitchell thing? I asked Hank.
I don't have much right now in the way of whether or not I'll help Natalie or Garrett, because I don't have the facts of the case.
Hank got us Coke while I put the corn pudding in the oven. He sat down at the small cafe table for two that was the perfect size for my small camper van.
I called Granny to see what they had, and she said she'd get back with me. They were all running around like they had no idea what they were doing.
He snickered and played with the lid of the candle, which was shaped like a pumpkin. Holidays were one of my favorite times to decorate, and as soon as the first day of fall hit, I had decorated my camper van with all things Halloween. I even took down my twinkling lights strung all over the inside of my camper van and replaced them with little pumpkin and bat lights. I changed the small area rugs out for ghosts and goblins, and even my bed covers in my bedroom to sheets with fall leaves printed on them. It didn't stop there. Once November hit, I'd switched all the Halloween items to fall items, more along the lines of pumpkins and leaves, though I did put the clear twinkly lights back up and all the Halloween things in storage. Even the soaps in the bathroom and kitchen sinks were switched out to fall scents in glittery pumpkin-shaped containers. The holidays had a certain feel-good to them. And even though the holidays were sometimes tough due to the nature of my blood family, I knew my friends and Mary Elizabeth were family that I'd been able to choose and keep, making it a little easier to fill the void in my heart. Now that I had Hank, and even though we weren't super close with his parents, I still felt a belonging of family.
Did you know Christine Watson dated Mitchell back in the day?
I asked Hank.
Are you having some sort of notion about snooping around?
Hank glared at me from across the table as I stood next to the small love seat to fold the blanket with the words, "It's fall, y'all," printed really big.
No, it's just in my nature to think this way.
I shrugged, laid the blanket over the right arm of the love seat, since Chester had found a comfy spot, and snuggled up to the left side of the couch. I guess when I found the memorial for Theodore Redford on the trail, it seems like it's all a strange coincidence. Not that I was all woo-woo or anything, but it was like one of those times you'd hear about when you think of someone, and literally the next day you see them, or they call you. It was kind of like that. I saw the memorial because of a squirrel, and now his cousin ends up dead? Again, coincidence?
I didn't even think about that.
The lines between Hank's eyes deepened. He picked up his Coke and took a drink.
You were on the trail?
Worry laced his words. The running group took it, and I had stopped. When I did, it was near the memorial for him. I'd not realized it was a memorial until I uncovered the small cross where the laminated burial card had been held there with a small nail. I tidied up all the junk I'd put in the two captain's chairs that were turned around to make more seating in the camper van. Things like Fifi's leash, which went into a basket near the chairs, my purse, and the week-old junk mail that needed to go in the garbage can. Things haphazardly thrown around. That even surprised me, since I was really a clean freak and kept things picked up. Lately, I had found myself spending more and more time outside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.